Good morning, everyone. Now let's discuss about the fifth unit, manufacturing of solar cells. And I hope we have already discussed the unit number 4, solar cell parameters, and I have already uploaded all the videos in the Google Classroom as a YouTube links. And I hope you have gone through them. Right? Now let's start our fifth unit, which is the last in the SPVT 1. Coming to the syllabus, it consists of different types of solar cells, manufacturing of different types of solar cells, or the structure of different types of solar cells, production process of single crystalline solar cells, multicrystalline solar cells, amorphous silicon, cadmium telluride, copper, indium, gallium, diselenide cells, and introduction to multi-junction cells. And in order to understand this, let's first categorize the solar cells into different generations. Right, the first generation solar cells are called the crystalline solar cells. There are two different types of solar cells are there. One is a monocrystalline solar cell, other one is a polycrystalline solar cell. Monocrystalline means the complete solar cell is made of panel is made of a single crystal. Right, C_SI means C for crystalline. It is called that the first generation is based on a technology called crystalline silicon. Right. The second one is a polycrystalline silicon. It's a monocrystalline or single crystalline silicon cells, polycrystalline silicon cells, polysilicon or single silicon. Second generation solar cells are based on a technology called thin film solar cells. There are three different types of technologies. One is amorphous silicon, ASI means A for amorphous. Second one is cadmium telluride. Third one is copper, indium, gallium, diselenide, CIGS alloy. The material with which the solar panel is made in this case of second generation solar cells are of two types. The first type is a silicon, it's amorphous silicon. The second two are the non-silicon type solar cells. CDTE means cadmium telluride, CIGS means copper, indium, gallium, diselenide. These are the two different types of materials with which the solar cell is made for the very first time in the history of the solar panel manufacturing. It is called a second generation solar cells. Right. Now, from the second generation solar cells, we are coming into a concept called non-silicon solar cells. The third generation solar cells, there are many different types of solar cells are there. Photoelectrochemical cells, gadget cells, are disensitized solar cells, or polymer solar cells, or nanocrystalline solar cells. These are the third category of solar cells. Right. But these category of solar cells are not given in our syllabus. So we are not discussing about the third generation solar cells, and we will discuss about them in detail in the SPVT 2. Right. Now, for the time being, we are not discussing much about this second generation, third generation solar cells. And the fourth generation solar cells are perovskite solar cells, and the last one is hybrid inorganic crystals within a polymer matrix. And we are not even discussing with this fourth generation solar cells except the last point called polymer matrix, which is nothing but multi-junction solar cells. That concept we'll see. Multi-junction solar cells which are used in space applications, that is the solar cells which are used for to power the satellites or the multi-junction solar cells, that we'll see now. So altogether we are going to see six different types of solar cells. The first one is a monocrystalline solar cell, polycrystalline solar cell is the second one, amorphous solar cell is the third one, cadmium telluride solar cell is the fourth one, copper, indium, gallium, diselenide solar cell is the fifth one, and the last one is the multi-junction solar cells, which is a part of polymer matrix, which we will see as a sixth type. This is all about the six different types of solar cells we will see. Right. And coming to the, as I already told you, the first generation solar cells are the silicon solar cells, silicon based. And second generation solar cells are based on thin films. They are like X-rays or stickers or PVC, you can say they are like a OHP sheet size or an X-rays type. The third generation is disensitized or organic solar cells, which we are discussing yet. The fourth generation is hybrid solar cells, plasmonic, inorganic, inorganic, etc. All these things we are not discussing about it. We are discussing about first generation and second generation plus a part of the fourth generation, which is a multi-junction solar cell in this particular unit. Right? Now in this video, let me talk about the first generation solar cells. These first generation solar cells, I already told you, are made from silicon. And they're currently the most efficient solar cell available for residential use and account for around 80% of the solar cells sold around the world. That is, 80% of the solar panels which are manufactured in the world are of still first generation solar cells, because they are the very highly efficient solar cells. Obviously, more than 80% of the solar cells manufactured in the world are of this kind. Right? Why these are used? Because there are two different reasons. Silicon is second most abundant element on the Earth's crust. It's the first reason, and that's why the cost of manufacturing is less. And second thing is, it's most efficient and longer lasting than non-silicon based cells. It is the most efficient solar cell, as well as the longer lasting than non-silicon. It is more durable than other non-silicon based solar cells. There are currently two different types of silicon based solar cells available in the market, and these are based upon the types of silicon used. There are two different types of first generation solar cells. The first one is a monocrystalline solar cell. A second one is a polycrystalline solar cell. Monocrystalline solar cell is also called single crystalline solar cell. These monocrystalline solar cells, they have a crystal lattice of the entire sample is continuous. The crystal lattice of the entire sample is continuous in case of a monocrystalline. But whereas a polycrystalline, the crystal lattice is not uniform, and they are made up of different grain sizes and different orientations. But whereas in monocrystalline, the different grains of a silicon are oriented continuously or properly and with the same or similar size and orientation. But the polycrystalline, they are of different sizes, and their orientation is also not same, not uniform. Right? Now let's talk about them in detail. First of all, let's talk about the structure of a first generation solar cells. As you already know that the solar cells are made up of p-n junction diode, the first generation. Basically, we have a p-type layer and we have an n-type layer. In between, we have a p-n junction. This we already know about that. The green color one is a n-type layer, and the light blue color one is a p-type layer, right? And then in between, we have a p-n junction formation, and on the bottom of it, we have a metal backing. That metal is called a aluminium metal, and that is used for the mechanical support and backing for energy transfer, right? And then at the top of it, on the n side, there are three layers. The first layer is the anti-reflective coating, from the bottom. And the next layer is the metal contacts. The top layer is the glass. Now let's discuss what are all different types of things. So anti-reflective coating on top of a silicon. Why we have to use this anti-reflective coating means to maximize the use of photons hitting the cell. That is, whenever the sunlight falls on the solar cell, some of the light will be reflected, and this anti-reflective coating will reduce that reflected light, so that more amount of light will be transferred into the solar cell, and thereby you will get more amount of photons and more amount of photon electron phase, and thereby more amount of electricity. That is it. Right? One photon will give you one hole and electron pair. Right? If number of photons are falling on the solar cell are more, means number of electron hole pairs are more, and therefore the magnitude of electricity produced will be more. That is the reason why. So it is made up of titanium oxide, TiO2, or silicon nitride, SiNX. This anti-reflective coating material is made of titanium oxide, TiO2, or silicon nitride, is SiNX. And then metal contact. This metal contact will be used for collection of the on the n side we will collect the electrons, and these metal contacts will be used to collect the electrons and pass it through the external loads. And this metal backup, aluminium backup layer at the back will also be used for energy transfer, in the sense they will collect the holes and they will transfer it to the external circuit. And there is one more thing called glass on top of the first generation solar cell structure, and that glass is used for the protection of the elements. It will completely encompasses the complete panel inside the glass. It will be laminated by the glass. It is the structure of a first generation solar cells. You know, there are two different types of solar cells, monocrystalline and polycrystalline. Now let's talk about monocrystalline and polycrystalline. Monocrystalline solar cells is the oldest solar cell technology and still most popular and efficient solar cell technology. It is the monocrystalline solar technology. See, this monocrystalline solar technology is very efficient as well as costly also, because the monocrystalline solar cells are sliced from a single crystal. Single large crystal. So it is very difficult to grow a single large crystal, and we need to maintain a controlled conditions for doing this. But it is very highly efficient, around 24.2%, and we can produce more amount of electricity for a given area of a panel. Right? What is the meaning of given area of a panel? So suppose I am telling you now, the efficiency of a monocrystalline solar cell is 24.2%, whereas the efficiency of a polycrystalline solar cell is 19%. That is, for a same size, from a same size module, I'll get 24% of electricity from a monocrystalline and only 19% electricity from a polycrystalline. So in order to get 24%, I need to add one more polycrystalline panel there. So the number of panels are reduced. That is the reason why the area is reduced. However, growing large crystals of pure silicon is a difficult and very energy intensive process. So the production cost of this type of panel are historically the highest of all the solar panel types. So growing a single large crystals of silicon is very difficult, and it's a very, very highly energy consuming process, called energy consuming or energy intensive project. It will consume more amount of energy for production of these monocrystalline solar cells. And one more point that we need to concentrate about the monocrystalline solar cells is that their efficiency is reduces as the temperature becomes more than 25 degrees centigrade. The standard test conditions are 25 degrees centigrade for a solar cell. So if the temperature is slightly increased, then the efficiency will drastically decreases in case of a monocrystalline solar cells, which is a very, very damaging point as well, as long as monocrystalline solar cells are concerned. This is about the monocrystalline solar cells, right? And the second type is polycrystalline solar cells. These are also called multicrystalline solar cells, and these are the least expensive compared to monocrystalline. They are less expensive. The reason for this less expensiveness is because of the way the silicon which is used to fabricate these polycrystalline solar cells are made. It is cheaper to produce silicon wafers in module from multiple silicon crystals rather than from a single crystal, as the conditions for growth do not need to be tightly controlled. That is, we can take different silicons manufactured at different points. There is no need to generate a there is no need to extract a single silicon from a single area or a single manufacturing unit. We can get silicon from different places and we can mix it. We can heat it and we can put them in the molds to manufacture this polycrystalline solar cells. Their efficiency is less compared to monocrystalline. As I told you, it is 19.3%. There is one more interesting point in polycrystalline solar cells is that it can be recognized by a visible grain called metal flaking effect. So what is this metal flaking effect? We'll see in the next slide. Metal flaking effect. So what is the difference? On the left side we have a monocrystalline silicon cell, on the right side we have a polycrystalline solar silicon cells, right? But what is the visual difference? You can clearly see, since monocrystalline solar panels are cut from a single crystal, they give a panel uniform appearance. As you can see on the left side, the monocrystalline solar cells are of dark color and the corners of the solar cell are usually missing. You can see the corners of the solar cell are usually missing. They are not a perfect rectangles. Somewhat there is a missing gaps are there. But you can see the polycrystalline solar cells, there are no such gaps. It is uniformly made. But the thing is that you can see the color. It's like a glazing effect. When sunlight falls into, you can observe a glazing effect, which is called a metal flaking effect. It's because of the orientation of the silicon crystal grains and grains in the silicon, as well as the different types of different variety of sizes of the silicon grains and orientation of the silicon grains leads to the metal flaking effect. in the polycrystalline solar cell. It is how we can identify a polycrystalline or multicrystalline solar cells. So as I already told you, monocrystalline solar cells are the crystal lattice is entirely continuous. So you can see on the left side crystalline, that is you can see the size of the silicon atom is same, their orientation is same. But whereas you can see in the polycrystalline, the size of the silicon atom is different. The second thing is the variations, there are different, they are not uniform. They are not uniform because they are taken from different silicons. The first, there you can see in this diagram itself, there are three different types of silicons. Right, and the top layer we have two different types of silicons. The bottom layer we have three different types of silicon. So that is three different types of silicons taken from three different manufacturing process, and we have combined them to get the polycrystalline solar cells. But whereas in case of a monocrystalline solar cells, we will culture the complete panel with a single crystal solar silicon. That is the difference between these two. And now coming to the manufacturing process of this, from sand to silicon. So what is the, of course, silicon is the world's second abundant element on the Earth's crust, as we already know about it. What is the source of this silicon? Sand, that is SiO2 is the silicon dioxide, is nothing but the sand. The chemical formula of sand is silicon dioxide, which is the world's most abundant element on the Earth's crust, right? And this, when so the process is, I'll take an arc furnace and I'll add this sand with, and I'll add the carbon with the sand, that is silicon oxide, SiO2. Now I'll keep it in the arc furnace and I'll heat it to 1800 degrees centigrade. Now what happens? The silicon, this coke, this carbon and oxygen will combine and you will form carbon dioxide will be liberated outside, and you will get a metallurgical grade silicon, that is called Mg grade silicon, which is not useful for manufacturing of the solar cells. It is just useful for the laboratory purposes. And then that silicon is added with the, is dissolved in the hydrochloric acid solution at 300 degrees centigrade, and after distillation we'll get high purity trichlorosilane gas is produced. It is HSiCl3, trichlorosilane glass is produced. And after this, and this trichlorosilane gas is passed through a process called Siemens process that will be conducted at 900 degrees centigrade to get a high purity polysilicon. And this high purity polycrystalline silicon is used for electronic grade manufacture. It's an electronic grade silicon. That is, the electronic grade silicon is used for manufacturing of electronic devices like diodes, transistors, ICs, etc. And then the other way is, there is another process called a modified Siemens process, and by using this modified Siemens process we will get a polysilicon, right? And then there is another one called, after the metallurgical grade silicon is obtained from the arc furnace, we'll refine it. We'll use a chemical refinement process by using different gases, and after the chemical refinement we'll get upgraded metallurgical grade silicon, which is called solar grade silicon, which will be used in the production of solar cells, polycrystalline solar cells. And this process is generally a process which is used for manufacturing the polycrystalline solar cells. These polycrystalline solar cells are made from polysilicon, and this is the process by means of which the polysilicon is made, and this process is called casting process. The process by which the polysilicon is made is called the casting process. That is it. Right. And then this process generates 4 tons of silicon tetrachloride liquid waste for each ton of polysilicon produced. This silicon tetrachloride is a very harmful liquid waste. That need to be properly recycled or treated. And then from ingot to module. And now once that silicon is made, now we will prepare the ingots, that is silicon ingots. And then we'll cut them into different sizes. And then we'll slice them and we'll clean them. And we'll form it and we'll make them as a single wrappers. It's just a cutting. We'll get the slicing. First we'll do cutting, that is a big pieces. Then slicing small pieces and we'll make them as a wrappers. And then this wrapper is nothing but what? It's a P-type silicon. Generally we'll make a P-type silicon. And we need to make a PN junction. So I am diffusing the phosphorus on top of a P-type silicon. And what happens? It will become phosphorus is an N-type material. So automatically an N-type layer is formed at the top layer. The thickness of this N-type layer is 1 micrometer, whereas the thickness of the P-type layer is 100 micrometers, which we have already discussed in the third unit while discussing about the operation of a solar cell. And then that screen printing metal contacts can be made by screen printing. By using a concept called screen printing, we'll make the metal contacts on the solar cell. These metal contacts, one for collecting the electrons, and the other one is for collecting the holes. And after that we'll wire the metal contacts. As we already know, a panel is made of different number of solar cells in series, so we need to connect all the cells in series. And then we'll array the solar cells on a glass substrate. We'll take a glass and below the glass we'll attach this solar cell structure, right, array. And then we'll use a protective film and a encapsulating resin. And after, on the back side of it, on top side we'll be having a glass, and the bottom side we'll be having an encapsulating resin as well as a protective film. And after that, we'll support it with the aluminium frames. Right, aluminium frames are fixed on both sides. We'll get a single panel. And depending upon the number of cells in series is nothing but a panel. Number of panels in series is nothing but a string. Right, and number of strings in parallel are nothing but an array. Then we can make strings or arrays depending upon the requirement. It is how the solar panels are made. Right, here the first process is from sand to silicon. From sand we'll make the silicon, that is a polysilicon, and from the polysilicon we'll get the modules. Right, it is about the polycrystalline solar cell, and the process is called casting process. The second type is, the other one, the very important thing is called the monosilicon solar panels. And this monosilicon solar panels is manufactured by a process called Zagorski process. What is the Zagorski process? We are not going to deal in depth about the chemical elements into it, but it's very similar to that of a previous process. You can see you have taken a silicon, that is the SiO2, and you have got the magnesium grade, metallurgical grade silicon. By when silicon is added with coke in an arc furnace at 800 degrees centigrade, we'll get the metallurgical grade silicon. And to this metallurgical grade silicon, I have added the hydrochloric acid and I'll distillated it at 300 degrees centigrade. Then I'll got the silane, that is the highly purified HSiCLT, trichlorosilane gas is produced. And now after the trichlorosilane gas, that is doped with different gases like SF6 and NF3. And then they will use a different process called sawing and etching. And after these three processes, we'll add the EVA or Tedler to the PV cells. What is EVA? Ethyl vinyl acetate or Tedler. Then we'll add these two. Then after that, we'll do a process called smelter by removing the air, and dump process by removing the water. And after doing all these things, we'll get the monosilicon solar cells. That is, up to this, it is same. That is, we'll take the silicon dioxide and we'll add carbon to it, and we'll put in arc furnace 800 degrees centigrade, and we'll get a metallurgical grade silicon. Then we'll add HCl. Then we'll get a high purity trichlorosilane gas. Once this gas is produced, then we can go for a Siemens process. We can go for a Siemens process to produce the electronic grade silicon. That is, or modified Siemens process to get a polysilicon. These two silicons are used for manufacturing the diodes, transistors, and a semiconductor device. That's why these are called electronic grade silicon. And This is one more process called solar grid. It's a polycrystalline solar cells are made by using a process called a chemical refinement called casting process. By refining it with various gases, we'll get the casting process. Then we'll get a upgraded metallurgical grade silicon, which is called solar graded silicon. Right. It is about the bottom one is called a polycrystalline silicon, which is used for manufacturing of polycrystalline solar cells, and the above Siemens process will be used for manufacturing of electronic grade silicon. Right. And now, after getting this high purity trichlorosilicane HSiCl3, now we'll do three more steps here. Now you can say four more steps. What are those? The first step, after getting this high purity HSiCl3, then we'll dope it with, then we'll remove the air from it. And we'll dope with gases like SF6 and NF3. It's the first step. And then we'll perform a process called sighing and etching. Least bother what is sighing and what is etching. We'll do these two processes, sighing and etching. And then the third one is we'll add EVA or Tedler to it. What is EVA? Ethyl vinyl acetate or Tedler to this solar cell. And after doing that, we'll do two more processes called smelter and dump. Smelter process will remove all the air from it, and dump process will remove all the water from it. And this process is called Jacolski process. And from which we will get the single crystalline solar cells. And this polycrystalline solar cells, as I already told you, have a non-uniform texture due to visible crystal grain presented due to manufacturing process. As we already told you that, you can observe the left side diagram, visible crystal grain in polysilicon. You can see different, it's like a visible grain, it's like a metal flaking effect. It will glow like anything when sunlight falls on it. The advantages of polycrystalline solar cells are good efficiency between 14% to 16%, cost effective manufacturing, and commonly available in the market. The drawbacks are not as efficient as monocrystalline. Already monocrystalline will be around 25% efficient. Large amount of silicon is required for manufacturing this polycrystalline solar cells, and high embodied energy. Embodied energy means the energy required for production of this silicon is called the embodied energy. That energy will be very, very high. And coming to monocrystalline solar cell advantages and drawbacks, the advantages of the monocrystalline solar cells, it is very high efficient compared to polycrystalline. We can get the highest efficiency is 24.4%, whereas you can report up to 13% to 21%, commercially available in the market. Greater heat resistance, they have a greater heat resistance capability. So acquires a small area wherever possible, wherever placed. So the amount of area required to generate the same amount of electricity in case of monocrystalline solar cells is less compared to polycrystalline solar cells. That is, one monocrystalline solar cells can produce, for example, if it produces 20 watts, which is produced by 1.5 panels of polycrystalline. To produce the same amount of electricity, we have to use 1.5 panels of polycrystalline, but whereas for the monocrystalline, we can go with only single panel. Right. Drawbacks are more expensive to produce because of the five different extra processes added to the casting process called Jacolski process. High amount of silicon is required and high embodied energy. The total amount of energy required to produce monocrystalline is further higher than the polycrystalline solar cells. And final, the conclusion slide is, overall, the first generation solar cells, these are the silicon materials. These are the indirect band gap silicon materials. And it's the advantage. And the drawback is high cost. Let's talk about individual solar cells. There are two different types of first generation solar cells, monocrystalline and polycrystalline. The highest reported efficiency till date is 27.6% for a monocrystalline solar cells, whereas it is 23.4% for a polycrystalline solar cells. But what are the advantages of the monocrystalline solar cells? More efficient PV modules, easily available in the market, highly standardized procedure available. Because from the long they have been using to produce these solar cells, so we have a well-equipped procedure available. The drawbacks are most expensive. Wafers sawed from silicon ingots creates wastage of silicon. As I told you, we are using two different processes called sawing and etching. Because of this etching, because of the sawing process, we'll get a loss of wastage of silicon. Right, and then the polycrystalline, as I told you, the recorded highest efficiency till date is 23.4%. Advantages are less energy, less time required for production compared to monocrystalline solar cells. They are low cost compared to monocrystalline solar cells. Easily available in the market and highly standardized. These processes are also available since a long time. What are the drawbacks? More chance of the presence of defects. Less efficient than monocrystalline because of the presence of more amount of effects. We can see the grain orientation is the sizes are different and the orientation is different. That's why we'll get a more number of defects in this solar cells as well as that is the reason why the efficiency is less. Right. So on a whole, the monocrystalline silicon is produced by the process called Zagorski process, which is a very highly energy intensive process and a very expensive process. And polycrystalline solar cells are made by means of a process called casting process, which is much cheaper and simpler compared to monocrystalline solar cell manufacturing. What do you mean by this casting process? Molten silicon, that is a metallurgical grade silicon, which is obtained from the arc furnace, is poured in a mold and allowing it to cool. This process is called casting, and that is why it is called a casting process. In the next video, we'll talk about the second generation solar cell.